You're listening to the Best Morning Routine Ever podcast, the show that proves no one stumbles upon success ever. With your host, Lou Need. Every Mondays and Thursdays, we deliver cold hard evidence behind the power of a robust morning routine. Get ready to be transformed by the renewal of your mind.
Hello, morning enthusiasts. Welcome to the Best Morning Routine Ever podcast. I am your host, Lunid Lewis, and today I have the privilege of introducing a very special guest to the show, Miha Matlevsky. In 2009, Miha had four companies go bankrupt overnight, lending him $5 million in debt, contemplating suicide to escape the pain. As he looked over the balcony, he had a life-saving aha moment. He realized that failure was a normal part of life, admitting to himself that he failed to recognize he needed to stop blaming others and circumstances. This was the turning point when he made a choice to learn from his failures so he could do things differently in the future and to help others. Since then, he has climbed back to create a business and scaling it to eight figures in less than a year. His life mission is to help people develop a healthy relationship with failure, especially entrepreneurs. Miha, welcome to the show.
Well, hi, Lunit. It's a pleasure to be here, to be your guest. Thanks for the invite.
Oh, my pleasure. It's an honor. Your story is very touching. I mean, going from suicidal and then coming from that and becoming victorious. Tell us about that experience for you.
Whew, where do I start? I dropped out of high school when I was 17, and I started my entrepreneurial journey when I was 18. And the biggest problem why all of the failures happened to me was because I never made a point to learn and implement solid foundations in my businesses. And the first foundation actually starts with you, the entrepreneur. And of course, when those failures happened, it wasn't easy at all. I was in debt, $5 million, phone calls every day from debtors, not nice phone calls. I went through depression, anxiety. There was this whole darkness in me, not seeing any potential to ever climb back out of that. And of course, you know, you start thinking, is it worth living? And then, you know, suicide starts creeping in, the idea and more and more of it and so on. And one evening, I just climbed on the other side of the balcony, and as I was looking down, I was like, am I going to do this right, or will I fail at this as well? And it's then I started like screaming at myself. I used quite juicy words that I don't want to repeat here on your podcast. But it was, you know, like, you did this, you did that, you messed up, you failed. And it was for the first time that I wasn't blaming anybody else, because, you know, my failure happened in the midst of that financial crisis. And it was so easy to blame it on the financial crisis, on the recession, on the government not taking action, and so on. But at that time, it was, you know, when I really took ownership of my past mistakes. And that kind of was my aha moment, where, you know, I started seeing the light again, because if I change, if I do things differently, I can definitely do it again. It wasn't like I'm going to do it for the first time. I already went to millions once, so, you know, I can do it again, and I can do it better. And it wasn't a smooth transition. It wasn't a smooth ride. It took me 3.5 years of bouncing back, constantly fighting my old habits, old demons. But, you know, I kind of made it out of that. I was able to transform my life. Morning routine played a huge part in all of that. And then, as you mentioned, in 2014, I created a startup. I was able to scale that startup to multiple eight figures in the first year, multiple nine figures next year. Then I sold it to a Fortune 100 company. While I was enjoying my rest, vacationing, I got bored. I took out my phone and I started looking for meetups because I needed to be surrounded with entrepreneurs. And so little by little, I kind of fell into the whole coaching business. And when I was thinking, you know, how do I name this? I realized I learned most from my past failures. And every entrepreneurial journey will always be full of failures before you reach successes. And it's very important, your relationship with failure, because it can drag you down or you can bounce back super quickly. And the faster you are able to bounce, the faster you are able to fail forward, the quicker you reach success. And that's kind of like the main message of the fail coach. Like I said, morning routine really played a huge role in my recovery, because I do believe that if you start your day with a morning routine, you start your day intentionally. And if you want to succeed, if you want to get where you haven't been before or do things that you've not done before, you need to switch off the autopilot. And too often we wake up, we maybe oversleep for a few minutes and we start rushing around and we switch on the autopilot and we go on autopilot throughout the day. And then at the end of the day, we look back and we were super busy, but we have no idea what we have actually done. And when you have a good morning routine, you become in the driver's seat of your life.
Absolutely. And I agree with you. You have no recollection of what you did that day. I've been in the same shoes where I'm like, what did I do today? What happened to the day? The day just got away from me. And it's when you hone in and kind of grab it by the horn and take control, then you realize you, every step of the way, every minute, you are making decisions to actually create the next.
Yes, yes. And the sooner you start the day like that, the better. That's why the best thing is to start with a good morning routine.
Yes. And I'm like super excited to have you on the show. And I want to talk about your business, because you went from building four big major companies, and now you are coaching on how to succeed in business, right? Because there's a different niche. You've rebranded yourself.
I was an entrepreneur all my life. And then once I had that exit, I was able to pay off all my past debts, which by that time accumulated to almost 7 million. I really had no need to actually work. But then, you know, I mean, I will be 42 in a few months. I'm not that old. I'm still full of energy. I do believe that there's a lot that I can share. I'm not saying that I achieved everything in the business world, but I achieved enough for me. You know, I don't have a goal to go to, you know, $1 billion company or $10 billion company. I've proved to myself that I know how to do that. And it's kind of like more fulfilling now to help others than to just build companies on my own.
Yeah, because now you are adding value. You are giving back.
Yes, yes.
You are serving other people.
Yeah, which doesn't mean that maybe, I don't know, a few years from now or even a few months from now, I won't get an aha moment and say, oh, you know what? I've had enough of rest. I'm ready to do another company on my own. So that just might happen. Right now, I'm okay in the role I am right now.
That's great. I know you help entrepreneurs with their discovering their business model. You help them with finding their niche. You help them with it, like a starter kit. Tell us, this show is very geared towards finding your purpose and finding your avatar. Who are you to work with? Who are you to add value to? So tell us about some tips for the entrepreneurs listening, aspiring entrepreneurs listening to finding their perfect niche.
So what I'm teaching people mostly is how to lay down solid foundations. Business development, your product market fit, which starts with an audience, is part of those foundations. And especially I focus on giving them tools and knowledge how to build the business from a business owner point of view, not, you know, solopreneur where you learn and do everything by yourself. Yes, in the beginning, but then later on, how to build a team so that you don't have to work in your business and you are a true business owner. And then you choose what you want to work on. So, you know, enabling them to get to the freedom. And yes, the first part is product market fit. That is actually why most companies fail, because they don't have a proven, validated product market fit. And it all starts with your niche, your audience, who is or who are the people that you want to serve with your products or services. And I'm a big believer, especially when you have a lot of client work, where you have to actually communicate with people, is to choose a niche that you enjoy talking to already, that you enjoy helping already, that feel like a family to you, because it will be so much easier than if you choose a niche of people who you have nothing in common with. Now, of course, if you are doing an e-commerce thing, like an Amazon shipping, and you know, you can do a lot of digging through numbers, through keywords, through data analysis, and you probably won't have to deal so much with people. So you can base your decision-making a bit differently. But in most businesses, we have to deal with people. We have to talk with our clients and serve them and support them. And especially if you are, you know, in services business or in coaching business, which is really very human to human, you should be working with people that, you know, you feel being surrounded with, you feel good by being surrounded with. So that's how I always go about, is trying to find a group of people that have something in common, something that defines that group, and then trying to figure out what struggles they have, what desires they have, and then I just see where I can bridge the gap.
So the product market fit is not just building and developing the product, but actually getting in front of people.
Yes.
To get feedback.
Product market fit is three things. An audience that has a need, a product or a service that solves that need, and a business model that's profitable for you and that they can afford. That's very important. All three things need to click together. You can have a great niche, but you know, maybe you can't solve any problems, so you don't have a product. Maybe you have a niche and they need your product, but it's just too expensive for them and they can't afford it. And you won't sell anything. So it actually is a combination of three things that makes your product market fit. And only when you have product market fit and you can validate it, and by validate, I mean you sell a few, that's when you should start working on other things in the business development, like, you know, your content strategy, your logo and brand and website and so on. It makes no sense to do those things before you know that you actually have something that somebody wants and is ready to pay for it. And when they do that, you can actually survive and not just survive, but make a profitable business out of it so that you can grow later on.
Okay. So let's talk about growth later on. How do we define or strategize the business model that we are profitable in the business? Cause we're thinking long term, right? We're not just thinking a month down the line. We're thinking a year down the line. How can this be profitable? How can we grow it? How can we scale it? What's the business model?
I always start with the end goal. I tend to look 2 years in the future, not more, not less. 2 year is kind of like the right time limit for creating foundations, because your foundations shouldn't be created for where you are right now, but where you want to be. It's same as building a house. You know, you don't make a foundation for nothing. You already have your end result, your house in mind, and you build foundation that will sustain that house to be put on top of that foundation. So you have to look about 2 years in advance, where do I want to be? And then based on that, choose and work your way backwards. Because, you know, your business model can be completely different if you are trying to be a six-figure business or an eight-figure or a nine-figure. Even selling the same product, but to a bigger audience might be a different challenge. So you always have to figure out, where do I want to be? And then work your way backwards so that things are aligned with that goal.
Yeah, well put. Because Steve Jobs says something very similar. It's easier to look to connect the dots looking backward than it is looking forward.
Yes, I would agree with that. Yeah.
Start with the end in mind, with the end goal in mind, and envision it, imagine it, knowing what the goals are financially. So pretty much putting a very solid business plan.
Yes. I mean, same thing as building a house. First, you know, you go to an architect and they make a blueprint for your house. Same way here. You either, you know, have a business coach or a mentor, or you find tools online that can help you build a business plan, which is equivalent to the blueprint for the house. Then you lay down the foundations and then you start building up. Mm-hmm. But you need to know what you are building up front. And that doesn't mean that, you know, that's the end goal. Maybe after you reach, I don't know, multiple six figures, you say, this was nice. Now I'm mm-hmm. ready to go higher. But what would you do let's say you build a house, you live there for a few years, and then you say, I want to transform this house into a building, an apartment building. Well, the mm-hmm. first thing would be go back to the initial plan, revision it, see if, you know, what changes need to be done. Then you'll probably need to increase your foundation, make it stronger and so on before you can start adding floors. Am I right?
You are correct. Yeah. And if you want to add in a mezzanine, you need to really think about the layout. Bring out the blueprint all over again, because you're going to have to take down the first level.
Yeah. Same thing with building a business. So you always go back to the foundations, to the business plan. You first take care of foundations, and then you start building on top of that.
Yeah. I'm hearing a lot in your topic is a lot of foundation building. Got to lay out the groundwork.
Yes, because, you know, like the thing is, I mean, I used to, I'm now moving a little bit away from the one-on-one coaching, because it's just, I have to repeat myself on and on and on. But in the beginning, I was mostly doing coaching for 7, 8, 9-figure entrepreneurs. Every single time, we had to go back to the beginning. We had to go back to basics. We had to go back to foundations, because that's the boring stuff. You know, processes, KPIs, benchmarking, brand story, company culture, like that's all boring. You know, most entrepreneurs are the creative types. They are always full of ideas and, you know, marketing, sales and you know, creating something, creating value and so on. But if you don't take care of all the boring stuff as well, eventually something will happen and everything that you've built will fall like a house of cards. Right now, we are enjoying the momentum of good overall economy. Share prices are rising, real estate is rising, people are spending more and more. Well, we'll see what will happen now with the coronavirus and the immigration crisis in Turkey and, you know, U.S. elections and the U.K. Brexit and so on. There's quite a lot happening in the world. But, I mean, just a few months ago, you know, where there wasn't so much of that, we were like really enjoying the momentum of the overall economy. But if history has taught us anything, is that life never just goes up or just down. So these recessions happen every roughly 10 to 12 years. Now, the last one was in 2008. Now we are in 2020, which means we probably are roughly there. Now, whether it will happen this year or next year or 2 years from now, but for sure, some sort of recession will hit us. And it's in those times when foundations are super important. Right now, you can wing it without that probably quite successfully all the way to six, seven figures without having those foundations. But, you know, you need to prepare for the downward market as well. Mm-hmm.
And then give it, because then you want to be strong enough, standing strong to withstand it and while it corrects itself.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, again, we can take the story of three little wolves and three little pigs and the wolf. Mm-hmm. You know, if I look at all my companies before that failure of mine, they were all like that first house made out of straws. I was good in sales. I was good in marketing. But, you know, I lacked the foundation. So when the crisis came and blew into my houses, they all fell apart. If I would build solid foundations, that probably wouldn't happen.
For the sake of our listeners, how does one define our unique value proposition?
There is no like a formula. At least I'm not aware of a formula. You really just have like what I usually do is in that initial product market fit. I communicate with my audience. I really talk with them. I see what they understand that they want, how they want it, and so on. And then I try to see where is a specific angle that I'm coming from. Maybe I have a little bit different business model than the competition. Maybe they don't have to invest so much in the beginning. Maybe, you know, I'm local. Maybe, you know, it's my past experience. So I try to think, you know, but it's more like a brainstorming session, at least the way I do it with my clients. It's more like a brainstorming session where we go through, you know, a lot of different things, trying to figure out what A makes us unique, but also that uniqueness resonates with our intended audience. Because it doesn't make sense if I say, oh, you know, I can do business locally, but then I live in Europe and I serve American market. Mm-hmm. You know, that really doesn't help with me, with my unique value proposition. So, you know, what is it that I bring to the table? What does make me unique? What makes me different? Why they would more likely buy from me than from my competitors? And for me, it's a combination, a little bit of researching your competitors to see what they offer, how they offer, then, you know, brainstorming a little bit what unique angles I bring to the table, and also understanding your audience, what they want, how they want it, what they need, what they value more than, you know. So it's a little bit of research, how I approach it.
Yeah, so the unique proposition is, you know, really identifying what your talents are. What your gifts are.
Basically, if a potential client asks you why you should be able to figure out what to respond. And that's what your unique value proposition or unique sales proposition or, you know, I've heard different terms, but it means the same. Why you? Why would I care?
Mm-hmm. What's your story?
Yeah.
Yeah. What makes you stand out? Like your story, you started out because you have failed so many times and learned from it. And now you are able to direct entrepreneurs on how to overcome that, how to fail forward themselves.
Yes.
Very nice. Tell us, Miha, how do you get up, dress up and show up? What's your morning routine like?
Well, I mean, I do work from home. So my office is in the first floor of my house. So I don't have to go far away. But my first thing in the morning is I have to let my doggies out. I have four dogs that are all saved from the streets. And then while they are out chasing and playing, I make myself a coffee. And then most of the time, I start with watching a few TED Talks, just to get me inspired, just to get me in the right mood. Sometimes instead of TED Talks, I put on, you know, some nice bachata and reggaeton music, and I shake my booty a little bit. I just like, I'm a Latino trapped in a European body. I love Latin music, and it always gets me up. Like, so depending on how I feel, I would say that the first thing I do is check with, you know, at what energy level I am, because, you know, sometimes you wake up and you're full of energy and you can just go and crush the world. And sometimes, you know, you don't feel like that, you know, like you're all sleepy and moody. So I really have a look on where do I feel I am. And then, so it's not like a set morning routine. It's more like adopted to whichever mood I'm in, to get me into as positive and productive and the best possible mood I can put myself through the routine. So that routine is more or less to get me into the work speed. After I do some of that inspiration, I usually do a little bit of meditation. I just use the typical mindful meditation where you sit, you breathe, and you just focus on the breathing and clear your mind. And then I have pen, paper, and my sticky notes. And sometimes I sketch a little bit things on the notepad, like mind mapping things before I start putting things into sticky notes. Because I have this thing where I put one to-do that I have to do on one sticky note. And then once I'm done, I have another routine, which is go to the trash can and do the Michael Jordan throwing that into the trash can and doing my happy dance, which then gets me going and I can go to another sticky note. Yeah, just putting a few things. I try to come up with five most important things. If I don't do anything else today, what are the five most important things that will create the biggest return on the investment of my energy, my time, and the biggest step towards my goals. So I try to figure out those five things. I put them on a piece of paper, and then I plan out a healthy life balance for my day. You know, what are some of the things that I will do for other parts of my life? So I try to keep every day as well balanced as possible. And that's really my simple morning routine. It's not elaborate, but it is like a little bit inspiring myself, a little bit grounding myself through the meditation, and then really putting myself in the driver's seat and intentionally going into the day.
Putting yourself in the driver's seat. I like that. That's precisely what you do. That's what a morning routine does. And you covered on it right in the beginning of the show. You said starting the morning, having a morning routine, really, you're being intentional.
Yes.
You're moving on purpose. You are selecting how you start the first 8 to 20 minutes of your day. I love your notion of, you know, you put Latin music and reggaeton on and you shake, 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 shake your booty.
Yes, yes. I wiggle it a little bit. So, yeah, I mean, I've danced all my life. I really love dancing. And I was always in love with the Latin music, salsa, bachata, reggaeton, even some hip hop sometimes, you know, like just that gets me going and puts me into a good mood and so on. So instead of experimenting with something else, that always works.
Yeah, that's really good. And the TED Talks really stimulate and motivate you. I listen to motivational things throughout the day. I it's not just in the morning, but throughout the day, because when I find myself, I can focus more because the subconscious is more susceptible to listening to something positive and actually helping you learn new things that you were not aware of.
And so, yes, absolutely.
Yeah, the TED Talks are they're short and sweet, right? You get
Yes.
That's what makes them so powerful.
Yes, that's what I love. 10 to 20 minutes. That's for me. Like I was never, you know, how everybody was raving around this Game of Thrones TV series. I can't watch shows like that, that are 50 minute long. I just lose interest. For me, you know, I like the short comedy shows like Friends, you know, 20 minutes, that's enough. And TED Talks follow like that whole idea, 10 to 20 minutes. I can watch one or two and bam, you know, I'm already inspired. I'm in proactive mood. I want to change the world and conquer the world and all of that. And then it's so much easier to start. And even then, when I do start my day, again, I'm in check with, you know, how I feel that day. And sometimes I might start with easy tasks first and slowly build up the momentum. And then other days when I feel like, you know, the king of the world from when I wake up, I just go straight to the harder things.
Yeah. And I'm glad you brought that up because it's a misconception that you have to get up like a lion every day, ready to tackle the world as an entrepreneur. We're forgetting that we're human. Like we need rest. We get fatigue. We sometimes don't want to roll out of bed. But if we put on those stimulating talks, those TED talks, those motivational and inspiring things, that gets the ball rolling. But I love that you said, check yourself. Check yourself in the morning.
Yeah, I'm always like throughout the day, I'm really very much telling everybody to practice mindfulness as much as possible, not the meditation, just being mindful as much as possible throughout the day, being active, being in the driver's seat. And part of being mindful is also constantly checking, you know, with yourself. How do I feel? How do I feel about making certain decision and so on? Like always checking with yourself, where do you feel you are?
Absolutely. Check yourself before you wreck yourself.
Yes.
Miha, I love what you have talked about today. I want to make sure audience know how to get in contact with you. Tell us, how do we connect with you?
Well, it's super simple. So the easiest thing is you go to Google and you just search for Fail Coach. I'm still the only one in the world, so they will see all the results of my LinkedIn, Facebook, and then they can just choose whichever social media network they prefer and connect with me there. If they want to learn from me, I have an amazing free group on Facebook called The Leverage of Trust. So it's facebook.com/groups/ The Leverage of Trust. They can join that. It's all about how you can use trust to get some oxygen money, how you can use trust to speed up the business development, because trust is really what building businesses is all about. Marketing and sales is all about building trust. And this technique shows you how you can then utilize the trust that you already have built to fast forward in your business. So that's another good resource if they want to try that. But other than that, yeah, just Google Fail Coach and you'll find my websites, social media accounts, and then feel free to connect whichever way is easiest and best for you.
Yeah, building trust. That's how you connect with your audience. That's how you connect with your clients, the people you want to serve.
Everything is about trust.
Yeah. Every relationship, business is a relationship you're building with the client. It's a relationship you're building with partners. And I agree with you.
Yes. And I see, especially from people who weren't necessarily born with, you know, iPhones in their hands. So us older people a little bit, that we often struggle with, you know, how to create relationships online. How do we do that in non-sleazy, non-salesy, non-pushy way? So I do a lot of teaching on that. You know, how to approach people, how to create connections, how to nurture that relationship in really like very organic, very human way that feels all right to us and to them. Mm-hmm. So that you don't feel, because a lot of entrepreneurs I see, they struggle with, you know, oh, if I want to be an entrepreneur, I need to learn how to be that sleazy, salesy guy. And it doesn't have to be that way. It right. really doesn't. So a lot of the teachings in that group are geared toward how to really create and maintain relationships and build that trust and so on. So I really like, if anybody in your audience struggles with that, they are very much free to join the group. I do a lot of live Q&As, teachings, videos, like a lot of content to help people with that particular issue.
Morning enthusiasts, you've heard it here first. This has been Miha Matlievsky, and the value bomb that he dropped today were finding the perfect niche, laying down a solid foundation so you can scale up, but you got to have product market fit. And essentially, that is serving the people that you enjoy talking to already, the people you already hanging around, the people that has an audience, the audience that has a need, and then you have the product to solve it, as well as a business model that works for you where you can be profitable, but also your perfect niche can afford it. And I love what you said, Miha, about the business development, the proven method. Start with the end in mind. It's just like building a house. Got to put the foundation in place. Got to see it, the finished product first before you start building it. Miha, it's been a pleasure. I thank you so much for coming on the show.
Well, thank you. It was a pleasure really talking with you. I loved it. And I do hope that your audience will get some value out of this episode. And yeah, thanks for having me.
My pleasure.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Well, all right, morning enthusiasts. That's it for today's show. Thank you for tuning in. If you love the Best Morning Routine Ever podcast, we'd love to hear from you. So go ahead and subscribe, rate, and give a review on iTunes or Google Play. While you're at it, tell a friend about the show. Be sure to visit bestmorningroutineever.com and our Facebook group to join the conversation, access the show notes, and discover our fantastic free bonus content. Until next time.